Good afternoon and welcome to yet another roundtable on maintenance innovation topics organized by World Class Maintenance and Tilburg University. It's a pleasure again to be hosting this session, and we've got five great experts on the field of that we are looking at today here in the call, and the topic is mobile solutions. And mobile solutions is a bit of a generic term, and it is so generic because it's so broad. So we've had sessions on sensoring, on data analytics, on life cycle costing, on all sorts of topics, really condensed. It's quite clear that what you're doing is everything is making a better decision. But it's all on the conceptual side. Here we are at the actual execution side. We do stuff physically, mostly, with installations, with assets, and that work can be made much smarter as well. So mobile solution is a catch-all for all sorts of equipment that you can use, digital solutions, drones, the robots, whatever. Everything that makes the actual execution of maintenance activities smarter, better, safer, what have you. So that's the topic of today. I have my experts with me, and of course my my loyal co-host Roland, who's there again today, Lennart Hofmeyer. Can you introduce yourself and give an example of best and worst practice?
Yeah, of course, Henk. Thank you. Well, my name is Lennart Hofmeyer. I'm a product specialist who works for Stork, which is a global contractor in maintenance. I'm working for a business unit that focuses on more the specialist services, so the revision and overhauls of rotating equipment, high voltage equipment, and those types of equipment. As a best practice, I would like to share with you a use case that we did at Friesland Campina with a client of us. So what we did at Friesland Campina, we used two types of remote collaboration techniques, which I think you can put them in the category of mobile solutions. So two types of remote collaboration techniques, namely prontoforms, which is a so-called asynchronous way of communication, and it's a piece of software in which you can communicate with each other using digital forms. And we used a synchronous way of communication, namely Microsoft Teams, which we are also using at the moment. So in this best practice, we used a combination of these two techniques to reduce the number of mobilizations to the client side, but also to improve service delivery towards the client. We did this mainly also because of the different challenges COVID-19 is bringing us up. So going over to the client side and check something out, it has become quite challenging. So for that reason, we started this project. I think it's also good to mention that instead of a linear approach, we used more of an agile approach in executing this pilot. So instead of just focusing on delivering one big end product, we focused on delivering small viable products. In our case, we first ensured that there's the right connectivity in place, and that all the team members they had a mobile device, and in this case. A tablet. Then we start building our first form, and step by step.
When I'm listening to you, I'm also always trying to listen with the ears of my students, yeah. And they will say, mobile device, yeah. But what's new? Can you please explain to these people that there is still a part of the world where people use paper a lot?
Yeah. Well, I think that's the right question. If you look at the current work process at Stork, and I think that also applies for a lot of another companies, that it's mostly paper driven, and that also means that, that there is quite that we can still make quite a big jump in digitizing these documents, and instead of using a pen and paper document, start using digital forms. Yeah. And these digital forms they bring us a lot of benefits.
But it's not just Torque, I suppose, it's also the customer. They also have to sign things physically and so on. So Frisan Campina also has to have those forms, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly. And in this case, they could sign the forms using the same tablet, or by sending the form by email, so it was still digital.
Slow you down, Leonard, but there is so much more that you know that you're not aware of that's interesting. How many signatures does the average form need?
Well, I think we have one form we use, and I think in total that this form can have around 150 or even more signatures. So that's a form we use to manage the quality during the project. So these are quite.
And so that's already incredible for the normal human being to understand. But on average, so if you want to go as a Stork employee and do something in the plant at Friesland Campina, then how many signatures would you need?
I think on average somewhere between 3 and 10.
Yeah, and until now those had to be signed physically by somebody. Who you hand a sheet of paper, they sign it. And they give it back to you, and when they're not there, you have to wait for it, that kind of thing?
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So you first had to walk to the printer, print the document, then go to the first person to sign the document, then to the second, and et cetera.
And we now, it is 2021, not just because things at YouTube will... No, but that's the reality, yeah? So it's throughout the Western industrialized world in many plants. Still lots of paper, still lots of physical signatures.
Yeah.
I suppose it's worth mentioning that because, hey, my students, they will think, why didn't they have that 5 years ago? Well, they don't.
No, because I think in some places of the company we do have, and it's mostly, if you look at the organization itself, it's quite digitized, but bringing these solutions to the field, that's something we are still working on, but we are quite making some progress on that side.
Okay, great. Sorry to interrupt you so long, and of course not every example should last so long, but what are the parts of the story you wanted to tell that you haven't told yet?
I think that's the main part, but I think I think it's good to mention that the biggest challenge is not the technology itself. The biggest challenge is the people part. Is getting the people with the right competencies, getting the right culture in place, and that people start using the tools. And I think that was also the biggest challenge during this this project. But it ended quite well.
And then COVID helps, of course, eh?
Yeah. Yeah. COVID is certainly a driver.
Can't get in any other way. Then it suddenly becomes very difficult to walk into everybody's office asking for a signature.
Yeah. Exactly.
Okay, great. Thanks. That's a wonderful example. Mark Peters.
Yeah, hello, my name is Mark Peters. I'm Innovation Manager Smart Industry at IJzer Technology. And one of our best practices of mobile solutions is, for example, at Tata Steel, where we integrated in one environment an online monitoring system for condition monitoring with sensors in the field, with wireless sensors and with wired sensors, and actually bringing condition data to the cloud to be able to have experts do analysis from a distance and to go to the area of predictive maintenance. And we combine that with the same system working with a mobile app, and letting people do inspections, lubrication jobs in the field, that they can scan QR codes, know what lubrication to add. They do inspections, take pictures, take infrared pictures, for example, as well. And I actually able to do with the app and the smartphone in the field, to do lubrication inspection, but they are also now enabled by using a route-based measurement system in also collecting the condition data from machines in the field. And what you see now is that actually while we have people in the field actually doing the inspection and lubrication, and we have experts that do the analysis from a distance, that they are actually helping each other and are connected to each other. So the people that don't know about vibration can do the vibration measurement in the factory, and the people that actually have expertise in vibration measurement and giving the good analysis and the advice to the customer can do it from a distance. And actually, they are connected and helping each other in improving the installation and have it actually in a good condition, but also in being there very early, in a very early stage, to detect where and actually be proactive in the maintenance area.
Yeah, is the communication between those remote experts and the people actually physically there and inspecting and lubricating the machines, is that all done via the app?
So the guy in the field is actually using a smartphone and an app.
Yeah.
And the expert from a distance can do it on the smartphone, but they normally is using his laptop, of course, in going more detail into the data.
Is the data going via the app or is the data directly from the machine? If you take an infrared graph picture, then it's on the mobile, I suppose.
Yeah.
But so the vibration. The sensors could go directly. That's why I'm asking.
Yeah. So the wireless sensor and the wired sensor with a cabinet with a lot of sensors on it, like oil quality and those kind of things, are actually directly communicating to the cloud.
Yeah.
And for the route-based solution, as the people go into the field, they use the app, do the measurement, and then they use, of course, the smartphone to do the connection to bring it to the cloud.
Yeah.
So it's a mixture of both.
Yeah. Wonderful. And you say in the field, do you mean actually physically in the field or is it still in the plant? Or
In a production plant.
Yeah, in the production plant because it's route. But I'm sort of because behind you there's this on the background there's this bridge. So I thought perhaps this is a part of the maintenance work that is done physically walking around for long distances. But those plants can be pretty big, but that's not what you mean.
The plants can be pretty big, but the bridge behind me is because we are we came out of Scania and we are called ISIL Technology. It's a bridge over the ISIL.
Yeah,
so we are not building bridges.
No, sorry
for that.
No apologies needed. Not everybody needs to build bridges. Thank you, Martijn Glassen.
Yeah, my name is Martijn Glassen and I'm the Innovation Director at Stork. And I think I can build quite well on these other two stories. And I'm just going to quickly just share my screen just to add some additional graphics to it. So you just mentioned how big sites are, and they are big. And there are a lot of people walking around there and the people really at the work front. And for every, say 10 people at the work front, they're supervisors. And these are walking around as well. And you have to then, once you finish some work, you need to take your portaphone, get them all to come there. And sometimes, this might be a little exaggerated, but to really crowd around and to make certain that the work's been done well. And just to do that final quality check and the final affirmation, you can continue to the next step of the work. And this is often very time critical, especially during turnarounds. And the turnaround, for those who are not aware, this is a period of, say, a few weeks where the whole facility goes down. So the client's not making any money. So it's very critical that during that time, all the activities like cleaning and inspection and repair happen. And that the plant, if you say it's going to be 2 weeks, after 2 weeks, it really starts up again. So again, idle walking from one end to the other plant, side of the plant by a supervisor is just a lot of waste of time. So we've now started to say, well, wait a minute, guys, we already have a tablet on which we are sending for the turnaround which activities have to happen. So we have an in-house app called Prince, which we do this with, but it's got a camera. Why not also use this to dial in that supervisor? And in this way, he can just give that extra confidence. Yes, you can go on to the next step, or hang on, I am going to walk over and just help you there. And again, I mentioned we use tablets, but for the same token, it could have been realware or any other smart device. So this is one thing that's, you know, it's one of these things you just wonder. We've been walking around with the tablets for some time. Why aren't we using that camera? And I guess this goes a little bit back to the, you know, it's all a people thing that we have to get used to after decades and decades of having supervisors do a lot of walking. And maybe another one, which I'd like to just, because it's too good need to let up, but this is third-party inspection. So this is when big companies make huge facilities. They buy equipment around the whole world. But before the equipment is sent from that fabrication yard, say in Italy or in China, is sent to, say, the Botlek here in the Netherlands, you want to check that piece of equipment. And you want to make certain that all the dimensions are correct, the materials are correct, the certificates are correct. And you don't want to find flaws when that piece of equipment arrives in the Botlek. And traditionally what we do, yes, there were people flying around the whole world, or we'd pick up the phone and call somebody who's in, say, 100 kilometers from that site, and he would then go there and check all those things physically. And of course, COVID completely wrecked that model. It wasn't possible, but the projects had to continue. And again, you didn't want to find out a flaw at the construction site. So in this case, we've gone completely digital, which means that we look through the tablet and check all the documents, check all the measurements, simply but with the person at the fabrication site itself. So this is an employee of the company there, and we record everything. And we use some special software to allow us to annotate and do all kinds of other things as well. And you could ask, why didn't we do this years ago? Good question. But in this case, COVID is, you know, this is one of the things that COVID has forced us to happen. And now, you know, we just can't understand why we ever did it differently.
Yeah, yeah. It saves also a lot of plane tickets in the process.
And maybe those people loved plane rides. You know, and sometimes, you know, clients said, I'd rather still have that person on my team, be there physically. So I'll leave it in the midst. But I think we've really made a step forward in the last year, and that clients have said, hey, we want this and we trust this. And of course, also the process behind it and the tools being used.
Great example of indeed a mobile solution, I agree. Yeah. Okay. Next, Ron.
Ron Bezoen. Hello. Hello. Welcome. Yeah, Ron Bezoen, Asset Manager Asset Management Technology at Stork. I'm doing asset management all around the world, but mostly in the Netherlands lately. Besides that, doing 100% of work, I have a hobby, and it's a hobby together with Roland and other guys, doing world-class maintenance projects. 2 years ago, we started a project for a skills gap at technicians. What do they miss in the practice to use all these remote collaboration systems? And we pinpointed on the mixed reality variant, because virtual reality is a little bit different, because you need a person to guide you through the plant, because you cannot see anything. But we focused on mixed reality for maintenance purposes from a distance. Luckily, we had some practice at Stork sites and other client sites. For instance, together with Actemium, we did some tests. With Kuhne and Nagel, we did some tests. We had some interviews at Tata. We had some interviews at Fujifilm. And always together with some students, we were always enthusiastic. At this moment, we are pinpointing on the HoloLens 2 in different ways. One part for world-class maintenance, what does the mechanic doesn't he have at skills to use it? But on the other way, just for Stork itself, where can we use it? And what can HoloLens 2 do for Stork? That was coming to an end now, and will be further investigated for Stork and BCM, what we can do, how we can do it. It's a lot of questions for a lot of students. The skills gap in practice is not age-related, we found out. For instance, a 62-year-old blue-collar said to me, I should have this 20 years ago, and we was very enthusiastic. So new technology doesn't have any influence at age. They want to. But what we found out is that the introduction and schooling was not always right. Yeah, it was dropped into the mechanic's hands and said, and we said, just use it, but maybe we have some schooling to do.
Agree, Ron, of course, that age has nothing to do with it.
No, nothing. First, we thought we first thought that it was age related, but it is not.
No.
We can still learn at the age of 56, and I still learn also with the HoloLens 2. There's another opportunity coming through VCM via Appia, so we all, as Stork, will also attend via Appia. So we will continue with mixed reality things. A special thing what happened at ASML, they had a COVID situation. They flew all over the world, like we heard from Martijn and Leonard, etc. They had no opportunity to fly again, so they introduced more than 100 HoloLens 1 and shipped it around the world, and they operate now with HoloLens 1, modifying it to HoloLens 2. They had to, and it succeeded because they had to for COVID.
Also indeed a great example. Okay, thanks, Ron. I'm always been enthusiastic about this topic, but it seems that this year it's over the moon. Good. Sander Verhuijven.
Yes, Henk, thank you. Sander Verhuijven, Asset Manager Digitalization for Kroon, Walter & Dros, especially the Department of Asset Management. Currently, one of the projects I'm working on is the mobile solution on top of our CMMS application. Well, I don't know if everybody knows what the CMMS application is. It's an application in which we work daily at doing our inspections, preventive maintenance, and corrective maintenance registrations. It's our best practice, but also one of our worst practices. The development of the current application started like 6 or 7 years ago, and it kind of failed, right? It had the lack of instruction support, development in time, and at this particular moment, we see our maintenance technicians working on paper again, or do their registrations afterwards. So at this particular moment, we're really looking at how can we support them and how can we provide them with a tool that really works for them instead of against them, right? Because that's the thing that the current application is doing. So
because that's the reason, I suppose, Sander, that you want this application. Now people, when they do maintenance work, they have to write it all up in paper. Do you also have in your setting at Kroon, Walter & Dros the problem that you need 15 signatures, or is there less with you guys?
No, that's not particularly the problem, I guess.
Because you don't work at plants, I suppose. Yeah? Perhaps it's good to explain what work your people in the field do.
The case I'm discussing right now is maintenance work at for example, a tunnel project. Yeah. The maintenance electrical or mechanical installations at a tunnel project.
Yeah, so not many signatures, but you need quite some documentation. This is what I done, and
of course we need to explain to our clients, you know, what did we do for the money you're spending, right?
So and how can this then become a best practice example?
How does it? Well, let's say make mobile work easy. Let's look at what they want to see. Did we see in the first version of the mobile application, we kind of like made a copy of the web application, right?
Yeah.
Too many functionalities, too many registration fields, too many things they don't need at that particular moment, and we have to make it smart again, just to match it with their needs, give them the right data and the right information at the right moment, with as less clicks as possible.
Yeah, well, I suppose we all have the experience that these days when you have a mobile phone and you end up in this site which isn't intended for a mobile phone, you immediately think, oh no. But in that case, it's not better than paper, of course, because then it becomes too cumbersome. Where do I click? But it's definitely, I can see that would solve a serious need in practice. Okay, well, I think a very nice tour d'horizon, as the French would say, of different applications of mobile solutions going indeed from virtual reality to handhelds and what have you. And also, I think also a good explanation between the lines, more or less, of why that is so very much needed, why it is so clear that there's an improvement opportunity in the execution of maintenance and inspection work. I think we are ready for our second question of today.